Well, that was fast. SpaceX makes progress towards the next flight of Starship. Will this be the booster to fly it? Pad B is nearing completion rapidly while revealing a few surprises. Booster 17 is halfway done. Will it even get a chance to fly? The next generation of boosters takes a giant leap closer to reality. My name is Felix. Welcome to What About It? Let's dive right in. Starship updates. Things are moving fast at Starbase as SpaceX is fully steam ahead on their next generation of hardware. This, of course, includes their flight hardware, but arguably their next generation ground hardware is just as important. SpaceX has had countless problems with the original design for their launch pad, from swaying issues on the catch arms to the constant repairs needed on the pad after every flight. And it's clear that Flight 7 was just as damaging to the pad as the previous flights. SpaceX is putting the same amount of work in after every launch. The majority of this repair work appears to be focused on the pad's quick disconnect. The booster quick disconnect in particular appears to have received a significant amount of flames in an area that is not very flame resistant. SpaceX will likely spend the next week or two replacing parts to prep this pad for Booster 15's static fire. Or perhaps even Booster 14's. And while many workers are trying to get this pad up and running again, its replacement is coming along extremely quickly. It will take more work, but SpaceX is giving an incredible display of how to build an orbital rocket pad fast. Starting with the most noticeable change, the chopsticks are complete. On the 24th, both chopsticks needed to be lifted into place and lined up perfectly before SpaceX could insert the gigantic pin to complete the construction. So, after rolling to the pad last week, both chopstick arms were attached to the carriage. Before I tell you about that, I have a question for you. Are you passionate about spaceflight, love diving deep into research, and dream of crafting stories that inspire millions? Well, here's your moment to shine. We're expanding the team and are on the hunt for a talented scriptwriter and researcher to join the Y team. And guess what? The best talent is often found right here in our amazing community. If you're ready for an exciting challenge and want to contribute to the incredible work of space content, apply now through the link in the pinned comment. We're reviewing every application, so this could be your chance to join us on this incredible journey. The position includes a very competitive full-time pay plus benefits, and it is home office work. Good luck, we can't wait to meet you. Also, our channel metrics show over 2 million returning monthly viewers who have not subscribed yet. Help improve the channel and double check that you've hit the subscribe button to stay up to date with our updates. Become a Y supporter for extra content. Secure your access to up to 7 picture galleries per week, satellite, aerial and ground photos, and 3D animations. Chat with me and gain more insights on the topic you love. Click the join button or check the Patreon link in the description for more. You rock! Then, in a moment we've been waiting for what feels like ages since these chopsticks were first built on the other side of the country here in Florida, the now complete chopsticks assembly was lifted into the air and brought over to the tower. It was then precisely lined up and attached to the carts which SpaceX had been installing on the rails to allow for easier movement of the assembly. With those out of the way, the only remaining tasks are the ship's quick disconnect and some minor work, such as installing more shielding. However, that will likely take relatively little time. Instead, there is another part of Pad B that's keeping it from being ready now. The launch mount, complete with a flame trench, is the biggest change between the two pads. Although this may not be as far from completion as you may think, SpaceX has entered the final work phase for the flame trench. This is because workers have begun prep work and grading on the outer ramp of the flame trench. Now, this may look like concrete, however, it's just gravel before the concrete is poured. This strengthens the concrete's overall structure and ensures that this ramp can withstand the force of the booster's 35 Raptor engines. The trench's overall structure is now taking shape so we can get a good idea of its overall design. It appears to be quite similar to what is currently in use at Massey's, just with 2 exhaust points instead of 1. However, thanks to our flyover with Redline helicopter tours, we spotted another interesting development, this area just next to the flame trench. Here you can see large amounts of metal rebar foundation, which is a precursor to concrete pouring. This is interesting and confusing at the same time, but there may be a few possible reasons. It could be just general reinforcement, as during a launch, both the pad and some of the concrete around it will likely experience quite a bit of force. Just think of IFT-1. However, if that were the case, we'd expect to see this on the other side as well, and it would likely be more diagonal to account for the direction in which the boosters will launch. Instead, this appears more likely to be something related to the actual launch mount. One possibility is the addition of a permanent retractable work platform similar to what is seen at Massey's. This is because the current solution SpaceX uses would not be able to properly be placed under the launch mount, making repairs extremely difficult. The other and more interesting option is that this is to allow for a completely mobile launch mount. We've discussed this as a possibility a few times, and it could be the first definitive sign to point towards that. And then there is the final possibility, which would include both. Although we will likely have to wait a bit longer to find out for certain, as this area is the furthest away from completion, even if many of the individual components are coming along very quickly, including the launch mount itself. However, SpaceX has been having trouble with its work here and around Starbase lately, as the weather has been less than cooperative. Over the last week, there have been high winds and rain. This is most easily shown by the tents SpaceX erected to allow their workers to continue welding even in harsh conditions. However, not everything was so lucky to survive. Looking over from the launch mount just a bit at the gigantic mural that SpaceX placed on the side of their parking garage, we can see that some of the panels were completely blown off. Man, this is quite unfortunate, as the mural is truly a sight to behold. I hope that SpaceX can easily repair it. However, they may also decide to wait, as the whole area will likely undergo massive amounts of construction soon. The first steps towards SpaceX's eventual next huge Star Factory expansion have been completed. But first, here is a word from our wonderful sponsor. Today's episode is brought to you by my friends at the Mars Gallery. This is not your typical video sponsor, this is art. 3D artists with over 20 years of CG expertise and a passion for space exploration. As a proud customer of the Mars Gallery, I can personally vouch for the outstanding quality of their prints. In fact, the very first artwork I hung when I moved into my new home was from them. These are large format pieces printed by the number one choice for photographers and artists. Every piece is limited edition, comes with a certificate of authenticity, and even offers an NFT option. Use my exclusive code YFREE for free shipping, don't miss out! Now, what is this next expansion of the Star Factory? What do I mean by that? We knew that SpaceX was developing a gigabay to increase its vertical space so that it could simultaneously work on more ships and boosters. There had been some speculation about where this gigabay may go. However, most signs pointed to this location next to the parking garage, which includes the High Bay and Stargate facility. However, there is a problem. SpaceX doesn't actually own this building. Yep, this Stargate building, which had been used as one of the main control facilities for Starbase since its beginning, was never wholly owned by SpaceX. Instead, it was actually owned by the University of Texas and used for satellite tracking and communication. However, SpaceX has now bought this building, meaning they'll now be able to build their gigabay in this area. Now, this is a great thing, as SpaceX will be able to increase the cadence at which they can produce ships and boosters. However, I can't say that I won't be sad to see this building go. It has been a landmark here from the beginning and is the oldest facility at Starbase, so demolishing it truly would mark the end of an era. However, this will be for a good cause, and the extra space will allow for even faster vehicle construction. Although SpaceX hasn't reached its goal of launching a ship every 3 days from this one facility, its pace is remarkable. I say that because they are now well into development of their third Block 2 ship, Ship 35. This is because on the 23rd, the next piece of the ship was rolled into Mega Bay 2 for stacking. Looking at it, we can see that it also has the reduced heat tiles of the rest of the ships, with a taper added ahead of where the aft flaps will go. With this segment now being stacked, only two are still missing, and it likely won't take long before we see those rolled in as well. And that's not the only flight hardware that has been receiving attention. Work has also been done on some boosters. The most important of these is Booster 15, which is possibly the booster for Flight 8 receiving its grid fins. You might be looking at the third booster to be caught. With these now installed, the booster should be mostly complete. If SpaceX has been able to install its 33 Raptor engines following its cryogenic proof test in late December, then it should be ready for its static fire. Of course, it is also possible that a few other unknowns still need to be worked on before this booster is done. However, it should be nearing flight readiness anytime soon. This leads us to a question that has been looming over Flight 8 for a bit now. Will Booster 15 actually be flying on this next flight? In previous situations, SpaceX has opted to skip a vehicle, such as with Ship 20 or Ship 32. These two are still in the rocket garden, having never taken to the skies. But in this case, could Booster 15's place be taken by an older booster? Of course, I'm talking of Booster 14, which was the second booster ever to be caught by a tower and appears to be in much better condition than the previous booster to accomplish the same. Now, there are a few things that could suggest this. Chief among them, numerous sources claiming that SpaceX plans to attempt a reflight of Booster 14. This is huge. So the only question is whether it will be faster to refurbish Booster 14 or finish building Booster 15. If Booster 14's refurbishment process is quick and the engineers can obtain all usable information from this flight-proven prototype, they will likely opt to fly it over Booster 15 on this next flight. However, SpaceX's stated timeline goal for the launch of Flight 8 is before the end of February. It seems unlikely that they will attempt a reflight so soon after. Or will they? Never say never, there is a chance that we'll see Booster 14 fly again, and I am stoked about it. For example, SpaceX took 5 years to reduce the turnaround time on Falcon 9 to under a month. Now, Starship is an entirely different beast and is designed to have a turnaround time of hours. However, this is only the second booster to land, meaning it will likely take them some time to get to that point. And while it may be possible, it does seem unlikely. On the other hand, Flight 9 does seem likely, which interestingly, if everything goes well on this next flight, may also make Booster 14 the first booster to fly a ship to orbit and back. Honestly, why not just throw all the big milestones together? I know kids in the future will appreciate that on their history tests. Of course, we should find out which booster SpaceX is using soon, as it's likely whichever one will be flying next will be the one rolled to the pad for a static fire. Even if Booster 15 ends up being the chosen one, it may carry an engine from Booster 14, just like 14 had one from Booster 12, so perhaps they'll both get to fly in a way. Booster 15 wasn't the only one having work done, as Booster 17 has also been moving along quickly. Its downcomer has now been moved into the mega bay for stacking. This means that the liquid oxygen tank for this booster should be mostly complete, and it is progressing rapidly. Of course, just like with Booster 15, Booster 17 has a question mark looming over it as well. And that is whether or not it will be the last Block 1 booster, or rather if it will even get to fly at all. After all, for Starships, the last in a line of designs typically never gets to spread its wings, meaning there is a high possibility that if Booster 17 is the last of the Block 1 boosters, it may meet the same fate as Booster 4. So that actually puts this booster's survival on how quickly SpaceX can finish their Block 2 variant of Starships. Now that SpaceX has proven that it can land its boosters and that booster reuse is imminent, Booster 18 is likely never to be built. Even if SpaceX stopped booster production now, it could refly the Block 1s until Block 2 is ready. Sure enough, we may have spotted the first signs of this, as multiple rings of scrap can be seen just outside the Star Factory. This isn't just any scrap, but rather it appears to be Block 1 booster header tanks. If this is the case and these weren't just discarded because of design issues, then it is quite possible that SpaceX has already chosen to develop Block 2 boosters. There's more to support SpaceX's march towards Block 2 boosters, as Test Tank 16, which is theorized to be a Block 2 booster test tank, was rolled into the Star Factory. Typically, if SpaceX is going to scrap something, it will roll it over to the high bay and chop it into pieces there, as with Ship 26 and Test Tank 14.1, which both met their demise there. In other words, it's likely that this tank has not seen the end yet and is expected to be moved in there for additional tests to be added. This is also supported by some work that we've been watching just down the road at Massey's testing range. SpaceX tests all of its prototypes and vehicles at this location. One of its most recent focuses has been this new and improved Can Crusher, which is designed to stress test tanks to their limits by pushing, bending, and of course crushing them as best as it can. Recently, this Can Crusher has received numerous improvements and adjustments. This includes what appear to be hold-down clamp simulators that mimic the forces a booster experiences while on the pad. However, interestingly, while the majority of the other components appear to have been installed, including the hydraulic rams, which seem to be ready, SpaceX has opted to leave out one of the hold-down clamps. This one may have become damaged in some way, or perhaps it needed to be left out until after the test tank was installed. Looking up from the Can Crusher, there may be an additional upgrade. As you can see here, SpaceX has been building a metallic structure that is broken up into 5 pieces. Now, this is a bit of speculation. However, it is possible that this is for the Can Crusher to allow for engine testing. This is because one of the big differences to the Block 2 variant is the addition of 2 extra engines. Likely in the center to add additional redundancy as well as extra thrust. As you can see here, we have already spotted something that appeared to be for this purpose and that has been installed in the Can Crusher. However, this piece may be added to allow for different testing or to help raise the height of some of the equipment to meet the extended height of the hold-down clamps. But no matter what, we should see Test Tank 16 rolled over here soon to verify the design of SpaceX's next generation booster. These views have all been made possible thanks to the incredible team at Redline Helicopter Tours. If you want to get the same views that you see in our videos, go to redlineheli.com/Felix for $25 off. We're waiting for you. You rock. SpaceX does this a lot, and while most of us who follow the work at Starbase only think of Massey's as a test site, in reality, Starbase itself is only a test site. SpaceX builds and tests prototypes here. However, Starship's reach extends well beyond this coast. Moving to what is said to be the full Starship facility here in Florida really shows that. Although it may seem that Florida has been an afterthought in the Starship program, it's actually the end goal. Once Starship is fully developed and tested at Starbase, SpaceX will bring the finalized design to Florida for rapid and frequent launches. However, a big problem is the size of the Starship. While you may eventually be able to fly the ships to Florida, the boosters can't go that far, and given that these are the largest rocket boosters ever built, transporting them is essentially not an option. They're big. In other words, these boosters need to be built on site, which is why SpaceX is once again investing heavily in its Roberts Road facility. Recently, SpaceX began the process of expanding its facility, and it turns out they have a pretty big plan for this area. Take a look at this. The current lot SpaceX has cleared and is beginning development on is roughly equivalent in size to the entire Starbase production facility. This includes the Star Factory, High Bays, and Sanchez, which total around 300,000 square meters in area. Now, the new facility at Roberts Road will be roughly the same size. However, this will likely change soon. SpaceX plans to develop this whole area, which is roughly an extra 200,000 square meters on top. While these numbers are rough, they underline SpaceX's will to continue, as they will use the lessons and hardships learned at Starbase to make this facility even better. The same goes for the launch pad, which appears to be well into development. It will take the lessons learned from Pad A, and likely even from Pad B, to ensure that it is even better as well. Starbase is walking, so Roberts Road can run. Which is why you'll be seeing even more coverage of this in the coming weeks and years as SpaceX begins growing its operations here to match its ambitions. That's it for today. Remember to smash that like button, subscribe for more, and if you got what it takes, apply for our Y Scriptwriter team position in the pinned comment. Check out our epic shirts in your favorite space nerd store. A new Raptor design and our brand new Starship Block 2 design are both up. Link is in the description and in the card you should see now. Also, check out our print store at shop.whataboutit.space to buy a picture for your favorite wall. A significant amount of every purchase goes directly to our photographers. And if you want to learn more about the fascinating story of SpaceX's Raptor 3 engine, watch this video next to continue your journey. Thank you very much for watching, and I'll see you again in the next episode. Or finish building boost Fluster 15. Cursor to concrete. to the flame thread. To prep this pad for...